started since. So 1 minute recap. So the first attempt at recording didn't go very well, but all you've missed is a summary of what I'm going to do. So weak factorization systems defined using orthogonality and existence of factorizations. Algebraic weak factorizations are quite different. Today we're going to give an equivalent definition of algebraic weak factorization system by using orthogonality and factorizations. Like I said in the abstract, there's the definition of a weak factorization system, and that's it. Okay? So all right, so algebraic weak factorization systems, what are they and how are they usually defined? Okay, so first we need to talk about functorial factorization systems. So I'll use a little bit of notation first of all. So for these, the free arrow and the free walking arrow, okay? So then we can look at, so C to the 2 and C to the 3 are the categories of arrows, the composable pairs in C. Okay? So we have a nice functor from C to the 3 to C to the 2, which just on objects, it composes them. Okay, and it does the morphisms here are just commutative diagrams of composable pairs. And so then composition for those just takes the outer square, if you like. Okay? And then so functorial factorization, what's that on C? Is a functor write it as three components LER such that comp postcomposed with K is the identity, and that's the notion of a functorial factorization. What that means is that on objects, so this is going to take an arrow, okay, and so it has to pick out a composable pair. We just write indeed, it's determined by a functor like this is determined by a pair of functors from C to the 2 to C to the 2. Well, we can just write it like this. That's the image. But the condition that comp precomposed by K gives the identity says that R of F dot L of F equals F. And it also says something on morphisms as well. That's what it says on objects, right? Okay, so that's functorial factorization, very simple. So we obtain n of functors. LR, which are endomorphisms of the arrow category, and natural transformations whose components are of the following form. So there are are the following morphisms, so maybe I should lift this up a bit, probably, right? So there's always a map from L F to F. And on the other hand, always a map from F to R of F, okay? So these give the components of natural transformations, and so, well, let me just leave that. So then an algebraic weak factorization system is a functorial factorization with an extension of this, so that's a co-pointed end of functor to a comonad. Such that the canonical map, say LR, RL, say lambda, is a distributive law. What are the components of this again? Well, there is a canonical map, I'm not going to, it's not very hard to see what it is, but we're not going to need all the specifics of algebraic weak factorization systems or any of them for this talk, really. So this goes back to Grant Stolen and Garner putting the distributive law condition. This stuff a bit fast. Aspects, algebraic weak factorization systems. We have categories of L coalgebras. Should think of these as left, the analogues of the left and right classes of the algebraic weak factorization system. Okay, maybe, and so these, the more, so right, so do I want to write this down? Maybe. These are arrows at C with extra structure, namely being an algebra or a coalgebra. So we can write these as something like this. So we can think of a morphism of L coalgebra. It's a morphism F from A to B. morphism G from C to D, and then a morphism between these two things. An alg slash or alg is a commutative square preserving the extra structure. Okay. So for example, on the category of small categories, say, or whatever sort of categories you like. So here the functorial factorization takes a functor f. It's going to factor it through the common category. So I can write. Okay. Well, so this is the common category. So objects of the form, say, there are morphisms in B, whose codomain comes from an object of A, okay? And this is the source, well, let me call it Q of F. And we can call this, R of F. But so this one, Q of F sends alpha A down to B, and the other one sends A across to the identity on F of A. Okay? Gives you a factorization like that. And so these can be extended to monads and comonads. This is the monad case due to the street, and in this case, the OR algebras. So you have to get the extensions. Our split vibrations. Now, algebras. I would call maybe, well, they go under various names, which I sometimes, there's four versions of them, and some of them I can remember and some of them I can't. This one I can't remember, so I'm going to call it split reflections instead. So this means, right adjoints. So a morphism U from A to B plus a left adjoint to U, okay? With identity coeval. Say split because the co-units and an identity. Okay, so that's a very simple example. It's one of the original examples of Grandis and Tholen. But so the idea of these algebraic weak factorization systems is we're passing from morphisms having some properties to morphisms equipped with some extra structure. Okay, and you can see that in this example. Being a split vibration says that you're given chosen liftings, right? Satisfying additional properties that wouldn't make sense if you didn't already have a choice of liftings. So this, to be honest, this will probably go 15 minutes over time. If anyone wants to leave, go ahead. be unrealistic for me to cram it in. About 15 to maybe even 20, but I'll definitely try not to go beyond that. So if anyone has any questions, go ahead and ask. Now, just as in a weak factorization system, the two classes of maps are close on their composition and contain the identities, right? That follows from the fact that they're the classes of maps orthogonal to some other class of maps. Such classes of maps have can be composed. You can compose solutions to lifting problems. Well, there's an analog. There's an analog to that for algebraic weak factorization systems, but it's a bit more because L coalgebras and OR algebras are no longer maps with properties, but the different structure. It's not merely a property that they can be composed. Well, you have to say how that it could be composed in many ways, but there's a canonical way to do it. They also contain the identities. You might want to say what structure coalgebra or algebra the identity has, but that's always unique. Any isomorphism admits unique algebra or coalgebra structure, in fact. So in our example, you should forget about the abstraction and think of composition in concrete settings. So composition of split reflections. So we all know how to compose adjunctions, and this is just that. Or we could do composition of split vibrations again. So here you have to compose the functors, but you also have to put the lifts together in an appropriate way. And likewise, you have to compose the right adjoints, but you have to do the usual way of composition of adjunctions. And so this makes, in this way, L-coalg and or-alg into double categories. So, for instance, or-alg. So, what are these double categories? If you just look at a picture like that, how can you think of that as a double category? So, the object, as in C, the horizontal arrows, as in C, right? Then the vertical arrows. Are the or algebras and the squares are the or algebra maps. Okay. So this is a double category. You can compose these sorts of things vertically or horizontally. It's a very simple sort of one because the squares are just really, it's a property of being a square. A square is just a commutative square with a property. It's not really much two-dimensional going on. It's a very simple sort of thing. It's really single collection of objects with horizontal and vertical category structures and a little bit more. So you have a forgetful double functor double category of squares. So this is the one just with objects, so the C, the horizontal, and vertical morphisms are those of C, and the squares are just commutative squares. So maybe a couple of properties. If you actually write this as a an internal functor, so double categories can be viewed as internal categories in CAD, then the double category squares just looks like this. So objects and horizontal arrows, those of C, vertical arrows are the objects of this, which are also those of C, and then squares, which are the morphisms here, are the commutative squares. And then we have our double functor here. So on horizontal parts, this is the identity. So use U naught, all right, the object part thought of internally. And so this component is U, if you like, U to the R. Forgetful functor from the category of algebra. So this is just SU to the R, TU to the R. And we have a similarity for co-algebras. So you've double categories of algebras and co-algebras. So this also is faithful. It's also monadic, but the common feature over co-algebras and algebras is that on that we obtain these double functors, which are the identity in horizontal parts and faithful on vertical morphisms. Okay? And Richard Garner and I call those concrete double categories over C, just because you can think of them basically as ones like this, where the vertical morphisms are just morphisms in C with an extra piece of structure in the squares, something preserving that. Maybe I'll just mention I'll just briefly mention this. There's a semantics functor, so which goes from algebraic weak factorization systems on C, with morphisms of them as well, across to where you can look at double categories, that's the category of double categories, but you can look at the slice of that over square C, and this, so this sends, we just write that, across to this. This is, in fact, fully faithful, and this was proved by Emily Reed. And we can characterize its essential image. This is a result. And Richard Garner, as those, I won't go into this, monadic, we call it right connected double categories, or concrete double categories, over C. That's not a lot of stuff, actually. The concrete just means you've got a double functor whose horizontal component is identity, then concrete asks that this bit is faithful, and in fact the other stuff just means that this part is monadic, and then the right connected thing is one other condition. So the point is that algebraic weak factorization systems are determined by their double categories of right morphisms. So this is an extension of the fact that monads are determined by their concrete categories of algebras. Okay? It's not enough in this setting just to consider categories, you have to go to double categories. But now, so I can get on to the orthogonality stuff. Okay. Which takes a little bit to say. So again, this part about the definition of orthogonality, the stuff I want to say about orthogonality in this context is in my paper with Richard Barner, Algebraic Group Factorisation Systems 1, and very much builds on earlier work by Emily Reel and also Richard Garner and also Grandison Tolan. So I want to say, so here we instead of considering orthogonality of collections of morphisms, we have to consider double categories of maps, if you like. In other words, a pair of double categories equipped with forgetful double functors to the double category of squares. And then we can say what it means for these double categories to be orthogonal. This sort of orthogonality is really needed if you want to capture examples like the one I mentioned on path, or more structured sort of examples. So a lifting operation of JK, of J against K, consists of vertical arrows. So if you're given a vertical arrow, F in J, G in K, and square, the following form. Given a square of the following form, then it comes equipped with a filler, which is dependent on FG and RS. So we are given a filler as picture, which is one natural in squares, I'm wondering whether to write these things down. So is it clear what naturality in squares would mean? Maybe not, or maybe it is. I'm not going to write that one down. So The other one maybe I'll write down a little bit more. So naturality in squares is about if you have a square coming from J on this side, then this filler can be composed with a bottom morphism here, and that should equal the other canonical filler. So that's on one side, and then you've got the other side. And then there's also two, which is a thing we introduced in our paper, respects vertical composition. And so I'll just write that down here. So we've got, say, UF1, UF2. If we've got a lifting problem against the composite, first of all, lift here. So I'll say, first of all, do your phi there. I'll now write all the subscripts and everything. And then, secondly, you can lift to another phi here. That's now dependent on this one. And that should equal what you get if you do the single lifting against the composite. Like that. Okay? And these things should be equal, whereas they have different subscripts, right? I haven't written them all down. So this is, maybe I'll just IF1, G, RS. And then this one is going to be phi F2G, but then you've got phi and S, where this, that's this phi, and this one is just phi F2 F1G RS. Okay, so there's that condition, and on the other side. So, in the above sort of situation, so moreover, we can form say concrete double categories over C. Simply a morphism from A to B, plus, say, you can write it as a J, G lifting operation if you were to write G as a double functor from the free double category on vertical arm, right? But that's just, in other words, it has all this stuff. We have all these liftings against it means that for every vertical arm like this, we're given some lifting. Like that. satisfying compatibility on the left and respecting vertical composition on the left, but because it's just a single arm, there's nothing else you can ask on that. The other side squares, so it's a morphism equipped with a suitable lifting function, squares commute with those liftings. Okay, and in this way you get another double cavity. Okay, the things with the compatible right lifting property with respect to the ones on the double category on the left. Alright, so I'll start to finally get to the point now in a minute. So just before that, so the point is again, these, just like in the classical setting, we have a Galois connection between the left and right orthogonal parts. In this way, we obtain an injunction between these double categories over C, called contravariant, and yeah, same thing. So we can do RLP and LLP. And this is governed by the lifts. So it's of the following form. So this is an important point. So you get a double functor from J into the double category of things with right lifting properties with respect to K. Well, that's the same thing as to give a JK lifting operation. In other words, to be able to lift everything in J against everything in K. That they both essentially say that you have such lifts having the appropriate properties, and you can also view that as saying that's the same as getting a map of like this. Okay. And moreover, so in the paper of Richard Garner, so one thing we showed was that for if you do have an algebraic weak factorization system, there exists a canonical L-Q-Alge-R-Alge lifting operation. Okay, such that the induced maps from R-alge to RLP alcoalge and from alcoalge, so I can call that set phi sub R, because it's obtained by a jointness from the canonical lifting, and then we also phi sub. about. R inverted. So what this says is that there's a canonical, very well behaved way of listing out coalgebras against R algebras, and in fact the R algebras are exactly those things with the right lifting property with the coalgebras. But you have to keep track of all these compatibilities, the vertical and the horizontal. Okay. So a good exercise, I'm just going to describe it in a little bit more detail, but I don't want to keep you here all day for those of you who are in person. Sort of tension between trying to do one for this camera. So if we look at our example again of split reflections. So this is a good example, and playing with this you can see it all. Split vibrations. Maybe it's illuminating just to slightly work through this tiny bit. Since I started with an example, so if we have U, this is the split reflection, so it has the adjoint going, the left adjoint going back the other way, then we have our split vibration on the right, and we have to say what this canonical lifting map is. So at an object of B, we have the unit B to UF B. And so then we can apply S to that, so SB to SUFB, S eta. But now that's equal to GRFB. And now we can use the split vibration property of G to lift up to some K of B to split vibration. And this is our lifting, okay, on objects. So that's all given to you, that's all functional stuff coming from the structure you're given, okay? And so you could now check that that's a double categorical lifting operation, and also that it induces isomorphisms of double categories like that. So these determine each other in this way. Great. So this is the new thing. Or when I gave that talk a few months ago about factorization systems, the last slide I sort of said something a bit like this should be true, and this is the detailed version. So this is more just a temporary name, but so a lifting algebraic weak factorization system on C consists of, well, so it's going to consist of a pair of these double categories. Plus an LR lifting operation phi such that one, well, the two conditions that we just saw hold for algebraic weak factorization systems hold, so phi R to RLP L and phi L from L to LLP are invertible. this is the, if you like, that's the orthogonality. And then there's also the factorisation axiom. So I said that was the plan, to give a definition involving orthogonality and factorisation. And the factorisation one is that so each morphism in C has a factorisation as the underlying map of horizontal of a vertical map in L, followed by the underlying map of a vertical morphism in H. Okay, such that such that we always have this map, right? So we can do this map from here. This is a commutative square cross to F, where that's going to be the identity on A, and in the lower component, it's going to be V1H. And this has to be co-universal. So we all know what a So this is the sort of, this is saying that this is the value of a right adjoint, and such that the other one, which is supposed to be the value of a left adjoint, so this should be from F to V1H, and this should be U1G. Here, that's a V1 universal, I should say, in the sense of morphisms. In the terminology of MacLean's categories for the working mathematician, right, you have a universal R with respect to a functor. So it just has a universal property. If you give F to some other V1k, there's a unique lifting to a map from H to K, such that it factors through. You can write this in elementary terms. It's about universal properties of some squares, okay? And so that's a definition that says that that gives a definition of algebraic weak factorization systems, just using orthogonality and the existence of factorizations, but now these factorizations are required to have universal properties. So factorizations with universal properties, okay? Back in our original example, that means that we have our factorization of a functor through the common category, and we need to check that the right part of that factorization is the free split vibration, and the left part is the free split reflection. And anyway, so the theorem, which I'm not going, we've gone long enough, I was going to give a sketch of the proof of this. Theorem is that there's a functor from algebraic weak factorization systems on C. Right, so first of all, every algebraic weak factorization system gives rise to a lifting algebraic weak factorization system. Well, we've basically already seen all that. Well, we can call this semantics as well. The previous version dimension of this. Was one-sided, where you focus on algebras or co-algebras, and moreover, there's a sensible category of these lifting AWFS, and this is an equivalence of categories. So every so the two notions of algebraic weak factorization system are the same. It's not actually too hard. Mostly, it uses stuff that was already in some of the previous papers. The only thing that actually turns out to be slightly non-trivial is to show, well, there's a few little bits, but it's nice showing that ultimately it boils down to the fact to show that if the forgetful functors from these sorts of ones to square C, if they have adjoints, which are what you get from these universal properties, then they're automatically monadic and co-monadic and things, and you can use Beck's theorem for that. But yeah, the proof's nice. And maybe just final remarks. So in the definition, co-universality or universality suffice. So it's enough, actually. You don't have to check they're both appropriately universal. It's enough to check one or the other, which makes it a lot easier to check. But that's basically, I don't have an elementary proof of that fact. It just follows from this equivalence. And things we know on this side, and how algebraic weak factorization systems are determined by their left or their right double categories. But it must be an elementary proof of it as well. But I mean, that's quite nice. And then, yeah, just to summarize, this is, I think, quite a natural sort of algebraic enhancement of weak factorization systems, in terms of two classes of maps. So in terms of the usual definition, this definition is a bit closer to it anyway. It doesn't bring anything new. It's equivalent to the usual one, but it's just a definition using orthogonality and factorizations rather than some monads and comonads and distributive laws. And for that reason, it's actually quite easy to verify in at least some examples, like the basic examples, like the one I mentioned. You can check all this stuff easily enough. The original motivating examples, it's easy to check this sort of stuff. Of course, like, to get more sophisticated examples, the whole cofibrin generation stuff for me is essential. And I haven't really thought about how much further use you can get out of it, but I think it's nice that you can actually give a definition of the very compact notion of algebraic weak factorization system using some categorical or some enhancement of the notions of orthogonality, which from a certain perspective are quite natural, and of factorizations with universal properties. So that's it. Thank you. Any questions? Stop. Thanks for coming.